Hello and welcome to the Vibe the 3 and 5 podcast. I'm Cam.
And I'm Emily, and starting this episode, we're going to be reviewing the Syracuse versus Florida State game. So Syracuse did win this game with a final score of 76 to 67. Syracuse improves their record and is now 15 and 10.
The player of the game for this game was Joe Girard. He had 26 points, 7 rebounds, 2 assists, and he played 37 minutes. So, a really good game from Joe, both scoring and rebounding. I mean, our 6-1 guards getting 7 boards, that's really good.
Yeah. Some other key contributors that game, Jesse Edwards, he had 18 points, 12 rebounds, 2 assists, 3 blocks, 1 steal, and he played 37 minutes. So Jesse had a really good game. Judah Mintz had a good game with 16 points, 6 assists, 1 steal, and he played 34 minutes. Chris Bell also did pretty well. He ended up getting 10 points and 6 rebounds, 1 block, and he played 34 minutes. He did foul out of this game, though, which was unfortunate.
Yeah, Chris really had a good game, I thought. He kind of struggled shooting the ball a little bit. He was, I think, 1 for 9 from three, so not good from out there. But in Boeheim's press conference, he said, and I agree with this, he was way more aggressive this game, actually trying to get rebounds. 6 is his career high, so I was happy to see him get that.
Yeah.
And hopefully he continues being aggressive on the boards. I mean, that's really what we need from him. And if he keeps it up, I mean, I'm liking what I'm seeing from him, so he'll just develop to be a better player for us. Some other
Exactly.
stats from this game: Benny Williams played 18 minutes and only had 2 points. Boeheim said in the interview that he was good defensively and it was out there mainly for that. He still continues to struggle offensively, which is very frustrating, but yeah, 2 points in 18 minutes is not good. So another struggle bus game for Benny.
Yep. Some other notes from the game. Chris Bell seemed to have some difficulty with his jersey. So going into the second half, from what we heard, his jersey had ripped. So he wore number 52 with no name on the back of the jersey the second half, which was very interesting, but at least they had an extra jersey he could throw on, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, just seeing 52 out there with no name, I'm like, that's just so weird to see. But it got the job done, so glad he could still have a jersey and be out there playing. Some other notes is that Judah Mintz really came alive in the second half for us. He had a very quiet first half, and it seemed like a fire was lit under him after he was pushed by an FSU player and it wasn't called. I know I sent a text in the group chat with Ema and Becca. And it was like Judah's like so mad now, he got pushed and like he's going off. Like it really seemed to light a fire under him when he was shoved and it wasn't called. I think he had about probably 12 or 14 points consecutively in a row. So really good job from Judah getting himself fired up with that.
Yeah, sometimes that's what you got to do. And Judah
Exactly.
made some impossible looking shots, and I'm really glad he got fired up. And honestly, his playing in the second half is what won us that game. He was scoring a
Exactly.
lot and making great plays, so good work from Judah in that second half.
Like Imal said, some impossible shots. Like I was watching the game, I'm like, how do you make that? Like, how is that humanly possible for him to make that? Like, some of the shots that he puts up there is crazy, and I'm glad that they go in the basket. All right, continuing with Syracuse basketball, let's talk about the future of Syracuse basketball. So, from what we're knowing right now, the future of Syracuse basketball is quite uncertain at the moment. Everyone is all over Coach Boeheim for no reason. He's still a great coach and does everything in his power to have a successful program every year. Personally, I think Boeheim should continue to coach, and he has said that he wants to continue to coach. So hopefully he still coaches at the end of this year.
Like that, in the end, it's the player's fault for not playing well or not rebounding or whatever it is. You know, it's the player's fault for not performing up to their expectations and getting the job done. So then they sit on the bench. I mean, Boeheim's just doing and teaching them what he thinks will win them the most games. And like that, he's not the one on the floor playing. So it's not like he can really have an impact on what the players actually do on the court. You know, he teaches them the best he
Exactly.
can.
Exactly. He tells them what to do and what tricks to do and Sometimes it just don't work, and that's how coaching is. Sometimes you just can't figure players out, and it helps when we have other guys that can step in, such as Malik Brown, that will be better for us. And like that, for example, Benny Williams isn't playing good. He shouldn't be out there then. He should be sitting on the bench like he has been recently. That's not Jim's fault that Benny's playing bad. That's Benny's fault. So I don't know why everybody's all over Boeheim for that. It's not his fault that his players are playing bad. Also, our player situation is quite uncertain. It's kind of scary to think about. Both Jesse Edwards and Joe Girard are eligible to take additional years because of COVID. And I personally really want them to take the years, and I think that they should. I think they should take the additional time here. And as of right now, we have no recruits committed to us next year. And like we mentioned earlier and in previous episodes, I could really see Benny leaving. I could see him entering the transfer portal and end up going somewhere else for college. So it's kind of scary to think if we lose Jesse and Joe and possibly Benny. I know Benny's not a 25 a night kid, but still, losing him would be bad for us.
And obviously we have Malik and stuff, but either way, we got to get better and we're going to have to look into the transfer portal for help at this point, I think, because we'll have a good handful of guys leaving, in my opinion. So someone like Malik or Chris Bell could always come off the bench for us, which would be great. And we still have Justin Taylor, but I think he should continue coming off the bench. I don't know if he's really quite ready to be a starter yet. And I personally
Exactly.
don't see someone like Kwadi or playing big minutes for us. So hopefully there are some good forwards that enter into the transfer portal this year and we can snag a couple of them.
Yeah, I know Illinois had Matthew Mayer come in this year, and he's been really big for them. Seems like since NIL, the portal has been huge for everybody, and a lot of teams are growing into it and getting good players, and we need to do that because it's what it will win us games and will win us the championship if we even make it that far.
All
All right, now
right.
we're going to do
So
another segment about Syracuse basketball. So we're talking about transfer portal. So we'll talk about Syracuse. Where are they now? So these are players that have transferred from Syracuse to a different school, and we're going to be checking up on them and seeing how they're doing this year in college basketball. So, Emo, why don't we get started with Quincy Guerrier?
All right. So Quincy transferred to Oregon. And their record is 15 and 10, so same as Syracuse. He averages 9.3 points per game, 4.4 rebounds, and averages 26.5 minutes. So Quincy's doing pretty good. He would have been good for Syracuse if he didn't leave, but you know, that's up to the player.
Exactly.
Next player we're checking in on is Kadari Richmond. He transferred to Seton Hall, and their record is also 15 and 10. He averages 10.3 points per game, 5.5 rebounds, 4 assists, and plays 27.7 minutes. So he's doing pretty good, getting good minutes. So that's good for him.
Yeah, losing both of those guys really seemed to hurt us. I mean, I'm glad we have Judah, obviously, but Kadari Richmond getting 5.5 rebounds as a game as a guard, that's just crazy. Like, imagine if we had that. That would be awesome. A couple more players we're going to check in on. Woody Newton is on Oklahoma State. Their record is 15-9. He averages 4.4 points, or I'm sorry, 4.9 points per game, 3.7 rebounds, and 16.6 minutes for them. Jalen Carey, former Syracuse point guard, is on Rhode Island. Their record is 8-15. He's averaging 9.2 points per game, 5.2 rebounds, 1.8 assists, and 27.6 minutes. So again, another rebounding guard that left us is really, he's doing okay for Rhode Island, especially in the rebound category. I mean, crazy numbers for that.
I always liked him. All
Me
right,
too.
next player, Robert Braswell. He is on Charlotte. Their record is 14 and 10. He averages 4.8 points per game, 1.7 rebounds, and an average of 13.4 minutes. So I mean, that's all right, but it doesn't seem like he's really thriving down there. Doesn't even average 2 rebounds, and he's quite tall, I believe, so That's
Yeah, 6'7". It seems like he's playing about the same that he did for Syracuse, maybe like one or two more minutes a game.
And then the last one we're going to talk about is Bryson Gadine. He's currently on Fairfield, and their record is 10 and 13, so not that great. But he's averaging 7.3 points per game, 1.3 rebounds, and average of 15.8 minutes, so not too
Interesting.
great. Pretty mediocre, if you ask me.
It's very interesting because Fairfield is actually the second school that he's transferred to. So he was, I would say, on Syracuse's freshman year. Then he transferred to Providence, and now he transferred again to Fairfield. So that's his third college school. So very
Interesting.
interesting that he's transferring pretty much every year.
All right. There has been some crazy NBA trades. The trade deadline was yesterday, and we got a lot to cover. Some of these are a little bit confusing, so bear with us. But we're going to start with probably one of the biggest trades of them all, the Phoenix Suns acquiring Kevin Durant and TJ Warren in a trade for Mikal Bridges, Cam Johnson, Jay Crowder, and four future first round picks and a pick swap. So that's a huge trade, but if you're a Suns fan, congrats on getting KD. That's pretty big.
Oh my gosh, I couldn't even believe it when I saw this. I mean, we were thinking in the beginning of the year, KD either Phoenix, Miami, if Brooklyn wanted to blow it up, and I'm glad he ended up coming here. I'm sad to see Mikal Bridges and Cam Johnson go. I love those guys on Phoenix, but when you get a guy like Kevin Durant, you can't complain. I mean, I loved Mikal, I loved Cam on Phoenix, but Kevin Durant's going to bring us a championship, so you gotta, it's called a trade for a reason. You gotta give up some guys, and they might be some guys that you like, but it'll help the team in the long run. Another Phoenix Suns trade that happened, the Suns acquired Darius Bazley from OKC in exchange for Dario Saric and a future draft pick. So Darius Bazley, former Syracuse recruit, he did end up decommitting from Syracuse, but he'll be on the Suns now, which is quite interesting.
All right, another trade. The Jazz received Russell Westbrook, who is expected to reach buyout, so we'll see what ultimately happens with him. They also received Damian Jones, Juan Toscano-Anderson, and the Lakers received D'Angelo Russell, Malik Beasley, Jared Vanderbilt, and the Timberwolves received Mike Conley, Nickeil Alexander-Walker, and some picks. So that was
Yeah,
a big trade.
that was a crazy
Like a
trade.
four-team trade, I think.
Some possible landing spots for Westbrook include Miami and the LA Clippers. And in our personal opinion, I know we've been talking about this so much, but we really think Miami would be the better fit for him. Get Jimmy and Bam some help. If they're struggling, he could be another scoring option for them. He would fit well with them. He likes to pass the ball. Overall, we really think Miami would be the great fit for Westbrook, and if he reaches a buyout with Utah, hopefully he signs there.
Yeah,
All
that's
right, we're going to
perfect.
go over a ton more trades, basically all of them that happened. So, Jakob Poeltl went back to the Raptors. The Spurs got Kem Birch and draft picks. Patrick Beverley was traded to the Magic along with a draft pick. The Lakers received Mo Bamba in return. I really like that deal for the Lakers. Jay Crowder was traded twice yesterday. So he was traded from Phoenix to Brooklyn, and Brooklyn traded him to the Bucks for 5 second-round picks. This was a three-team trade. So Indiana received three of those picks, as well as George Hill, Jordan Nwora, and Serge Ibaka, who was later waived, reached a buyout with Indiana. Brooklyn received two of Milwaukee's picks, so two of the five, and the draft rights to Juan Pablo Viale. And he was drafted in 2015 and is currently playing overseas, and he's never played in an NBA game. So really interesting that his rights were traded over. So he's not even playing in the NBA. It's kind of weird though.
The Rockets traded Bruno Fernando and Garrison Matthews to the Hawks for Justin Holiday and Frank Kaminsky and picks. The Warriors received Gary Payton II. The Pistons received James Wiseman. Hawks received Sadiq Bey. Trailblazers received Kevin Knox and 5 second round picks.
Yeah, those second round picks were via Atlanta, by the way. And just there's so many trades, like
Yeah.
with so many different teams. Like we were writing the script last night, and I'm like, oh my gosh, like all these three or four team trades, it's just crazy. Like, how
Yeah.
does that many people get involved in a trade? It's kind of ridiculous. All
Mm-hmm.
right, another Lakers trade. Thomas Bryant was traded to the Nuggets. The Lakers received Davon Reed and a future second round pick. So Thomas Bryant was traded, and the Lakers got Mo Bamba. I personally think Mo Bamba is better than Thomas Bryant anyway. So it seems like Lakers upgraded at the center position. Mason Plumlee was traded to the LA Clippers for Reggie Jackson, a future second round pick. And later, Reggie Jackson reached a buyout with the Charlotte Hornets. Eric Gordon and three future second round picks were traded to the Clippers. Luke Kennard to the Grizzlies. Danny Green, John Wall, and a pick swap to Houston. And Wall is expected to reach a buyout with the Rockets. So, kind of unfortunate we're not going to see John Wall back in a Rockets uniform, but I understand the Rockets are young. So, we wouldn't want John Wall there, anyways.
Bones Highland was traded to the LA Clippers, and the Nuggets received two second round picks for that.
Yeah, so the Clippers got rid of Reggie Jackson and John Wall, both of their point guards. They acquired Bones Highland. I really like that pickup for them. I personally think Bones Highland is better than both of those two guards. And on TV, people were freaking out saying, oh my gosh, the Clippers traded all their point guards. But they acquired Bones Highland, who is, in my opinion, better than both of the guards that they had. So I don't know what these commentators, such as Richard Jefferson, are talking about. They really don't know what they're talking about, in my opinion. All right, the last trade that we're going to cover, this is a lot of information, so bear with me. This is a one, two, three, four, I think four team trade. So the Portland Trailblazers received Cam Reddish, Matisse Thybulle, Ryan Arcidiacono, and a 2023 first from New York. Sixers received Jalen McDaniels and two future second round picks. One of them is from Charlotte, one of them is from Portland. The Hornets received Svi Mykhailiuk, two future second round picks, one from Philly and one from Portland. And the Knicks received Josh Hart. So I'm really glad this trade happened. I really wanted to see Cam Reddish get out of New York. He was not playing at all there, and he really has a lot of talent, in my opinion. Really glad to see him get out of New York and possibly have a chance to actually play in Portland. So, really happy about that trade. Switching gears now, getting off of basketball because we've been talking about it for a long time. We're going to be going into some football talk now. So first, we're going to do guess the NFL player. So it's going to work the same that we've been doing it. There's five clues. You can guess it off of any clue. You don't have to listen to all five. And then we'll reveal the player once it's been guessed. So it's NFL, obviously, as I just said. So I'll be saying my player first. So Imal, are you ready for this segment?
I'm ready.
All right. This player is a quarterback. He is
Okay.
white. He
All
likes to
right.
wear lots of chains.
I think I know. Based on our conversation last night, is it Kirk Cousins?
Is Kirk Cousins. The second, two other clues were he went to Michigan State University and he is on the Vikings. And the correct answer is, in fact, Kirk Cousins. We were
Great
talking
player.
about
That's a
him
good
last
one.
night and about how he was wearing all of his chains, and it was just hilarious.
Yeah, that was a selling clue for me. All right. My player. Clue number one, they were teammates with Justin Jefferson and Joe Burrow in college. They
Okay, I think
played
I know
college
it.
football. Okay, yeah, say it if you know it.
Is it Ja'Marr Chase?
Yeah. I knew
Let's
the first one
go.
would kind of give it away, but I'll read the other clues just for the people watching. He played college football at LSU. He was a round one, number five pick in the 2021 draft. He's the first player in Bengals history to wear number one, and the player's nickname is Uno. And it's Ja'Marr Chase, as Cam said.
Great player. I really like him. And it was cool that he was teammates with some of our favorite players at LSU.
Yeah.
Now we're going to be doing a segment that we previewed in the last podcast episode. We did Drip or Drop with NBA players. Now we're going to be doing NFL Honors Drip or Drop. So this was their fits from when we're recording this. It was last night, NFL Honors, when all of the honors were announced. So let's get right into it. So I'm going to be doing Drip this time, and Emal is going to be doing Drop this time. But obviously, we're both still going to discuss what we think of the fits. So the first fit is Drip, and it is Sauce Gardner. I really like his chain, the sauce chain. The glasses are icy and they look really cool. And then the suit is simple, but it looks really good on him, I personally think.
Yeah, I love Sauce's fit. His jewelry is really nice, and I like the color of the suit. It's a little bit different. Overall, he's looking great.
Exactly. All right, Imal, the first drop is.
Okay, the drop is DeMar Hamlin. So we did drop for this just because it's kind of basic. It's just a pretty normal tux, just black and white. And, we're glad DeMar's okay and everything, but he's just getting a lot of attention. I thought he would have maybe brought a little bit more drip. He looks good,
Exactly.
definitely, but a little boring in my opinion.
Yeah, it's just way too basic for me. Just black and white suit. Like, you're at NFL Honors. Like, do something crazy, like what Sauce did, or like that, what our other drip players did. Do something crazy. Like, you never know. You might not ever be at NFL Honors ever again. So, gotta make it worthwhile with your fit. All right, the next drip is Justin Jefferson. And I loved his suit. The
Oh, he
jacket
looks
is
so good.
crazy. The black shirt complements it very well. I'm glad he went black shirt instead of white underneath. It looks really well together. The glasses are a classic Jay Jettas glasses. The braids, his hair, classic. And then he's got two chains on, which I really like. I think his fit looks really well altogether.
Yeah, I love like the pattern suit. You didn't see too many guys with that. And he's got the classic braids in, which I think looks very good on him. He always has good
Exactly.
fits, and he definitely brought it for the honors.
Exactly. All right, the next drop. This is kind of a meme one.
So it's not a player, but Kelly Clarkson sang at the NFL Honors, and she wore this very interesting Cowboys inspired dress. It's not my cup of tea. I would want with something a little bit different if I were her. So we have to give her a drop just because it's weird. It's like a jersey at the top, and then it's like she's got like a shirt under it, and then big poofy skirt with the different names and stuff. And it's the NFL Honors. It's not just the Cowboys, so
Exactly. And like
I mean,
that,
she must be a big Cowboys.
she literally took the nameplates off of jerseys. Like, she bought probably jerseys of all those players, cut off the nameplate and glued it onto the dress. That's literally probably what she did, or sewed it or whatever. It's not a good look, in my opinion.
No,
This is definitely a
hate to say,
drop.
but
Next drip, we got Kirk Cousins, as we were talking about earlier. My man Kirk loves to wear his chains. He's got a million of them on. He actually sang a song with Kelly Clarkson, which was quite funny. But Kirk Cousins drip. I mean, look at all those chains.
I mean, he's got all
Next.
the ice on. That's got to be a
Exactly. Next drop. We have Emo. Why don't we talk about this one?
Okay, so the drop is Larry. You guys might be like, who's Larry? He certainly doesn't look like a player, does he? No, he was the fan of the year, and he happens to be a Seahawks fan. So, I mean, that is cool. I like the Seahawks, but Larry is just, he looks like he's going to a game, not the NFL honors. I mean, he's got just a baseball hat on and then like a jersey, or even it might be a jersey shirt, but he just looks like it's his casual game day outfit, not anything too dressy, but we have to give Larry a drop for that.
Yeah, Larry, what are you doing, man? The fit. You're at NFL Honors. You're literally the fan of the year in the NFL. You couldn't have brought out something more special. I mean, come on. I get you're wearing a Seahawks jersey. They're your favorite team. You're a super fan, but I mean, come on. You could have brought out something a little bit better. I mean, even like if you wore a special Seahawks jersey, like a custom jersey or something like that, would be better, but Larry, you deserve a drop. Sorry, dude. The next drip is Micah Parsons, and he actually has a son with him. I think that's his son, at least. And they have matching pants on, which is very cute. And Micah's whole fit I really like. I really like the suit matching the pants. Like I said with Jay Jettas, the black undershirt really goes well. And he's got a little chain there. I don't know if you can really see it, but he's got a little chain on. So you love to see it, especially matching with his son.
It is so cute. His son there is absolutely adorable. And I really do like how they're matching. And again, with the pattern suit, I think that looks good. It's always a little bit different. So I like to see that. Definitely a thumbs up drip for Micah Parsons.
The next drop.
Patrick Mahomes. So he wasn't actually there because, you know, he is going to be in the Super Bowl. But, I mean, what is this fit? It looks like something an 80-year-old would wear. Like, no offense, but it's very, like, stiff almost. I mean, the red, I don't really like that much. I mean, he might be wearing that, you know, because the Chiefs' colors are red. But it doesn't look like an NFL honors fit to me. I mean,
exactly.
He should have went
His situation was a little bit different because it was a video since he is going to be in the Super Bowl. But still, I mean, your tie looks like it was bought at the thrifty shopper. The suit jacket is gray with red stripes. That's a what are you doing moment. And like that, you could have done something way better. I mean, you're the MVP of the NFL. I mean, come on. You could have brought out something a little bit more special. I get it's a video and everything, but Patrick Mahomes, your fit was absolutely awful in your video. That's definitely a drop for me. The next drip is Tariq Woolen. He had an all-matching fit. He had the blue shirt and the jacket and the pants and the glasses even matched. And he has a chain, and it says Reek on it. And the chain looks really nice with this fit. And overall, just a good fit, good color coordination with matching everything.
Yeah, I honestly really like this fit. It's pretty simple, but like that with the glasses and the chain. And I like how the shirt matches the tux. His hair looks good. He's looking happy. Really great fit by Tariq.
Exactly. I agree. The last drop is
Aiden Hutchinson. So I know a lot of people do like Aiden. Nothing against him, but this fit is it's almost a little bit too casual. It's basic. I mean, he doesn't even have his tux buttoned. I don't like how like his ankles are showing. Like, he's looking like he's, like, going to a beach wedding or something. Like, with the shirt unbuttoned and the ankle situation. I don't know. I think if it were my first time going to the NFL honors as a rookie, I think I would have brought something a little bit more flashy. But he went more casual, it seems.
Exactly. I completely agree. Aiden Hutchinson, your fit is a drop. No bueno. Not a good fit, in my opinion. Talking about the NFL honors, now we're going to talk about, we talked about the fits, now we're going to talk about the actual awards. So, Imal, why don't we get into the actual awards for NFL honors this year?
All right. So, Defensive Rookie of the Year, we have Sauce Gardner. I mean,
thank God
he doesn't love Sauce. He deserves it so much. He is just such a great player. He's such a good person. He really deserves it, and we love Sauce, so big congratulations to him.
Offensive Rookie of the Year is Garrett Wilson, another Jets player. So the Jets cleaned up in the Rookie of the Year categories. Jets wide receiver. I mean, he deserved it. He played really well. I thought Brock Purdy was going to get it because of what he did in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the year, I thought he could have gotten it. I thought Kenneth Walker was a good candidate from the Seahawks. He had a really great season, especially since injuries really hurt them. Rashad Penny was hurt, and he stepped up for them. But in the end, Garrett Wilson won. Comeback player of the year is Seahawks quarterback Geno Smith. He had a great year this year, led them to the playoffs. We thought Drew Locke was going to be the starting quarterback going into the year, but it ended up being Geno. And overall, he played very well. So, comeback player of the year, Geno Smith, very well deserved. I'm glad he got that award.
Yeah. All right. Defensive player of the year, we have Nick Bosa. He did good. The 49ers made it quite far, so I can definitely see why he got defensive player. And then offensive player of the year, we have Justin Jefferson. I mean, I don't think that's really a surprise to anyone. He had an absolutely incredible season, and he definitely deserved it. So good going, Jay Jettis.
Exactly. He put so many people on the highlight reel,
Yeah.
just catching over everybody. Broke the record for single season, I think it was receiving yards in Vikings history, beat Randy Moss's record. So definitely well deserved. Like we mentioned earlier, Patrick Mahomes won the MVP over Jalen Hurts. Unfortunately, we wanted to see Jalen Hurts win it, but Mahomes ended up winning it. One thing I said is at least it's not Josh Allen. At least it's not Josh Allen winning it. I mean, I'm fine with Mahomes.
True.
Mahomes played good this year. Obviously led the Chiefs to the Super Bowl. We'll see how that pans out Sunday. But yeah, Patrick Mahomes is the MVP this year. And then lastly, the coach of the year is Brian Daboll from the New York Giants, first year coach for them. The Giants overall had a pretty good year, and Daboll is the first year coach for them. So congratulations to him. I'm glad he won the award. I mean, being a first-year coach and leading your team to be good and a playoff team is really difficult. So, real
Yeah.
props to him. Going into our special segments, then we're going to wrap this episode up. My sports take of the week this week is that the Phoenix Suns are winning the NBA Finals. Pretty basic take, but as a Suns fan, there's, in my personal opinion, nobody in the NBA. No team that could guard everybody on the Suns. And with the Suns acquiring Kevin Durant just makes it even more difficult for teams. So my take this week is that the Suns are winning the NBA Finals. My chump of the week, we talked about him a little bit earlier with the drip or drop category. My chump of the week this week is Aiden Hutchinson. And the reason is that he scared me into thinking that he won Defensive Rookie of the Year instead of Sauce Gardner. Hutchinson won the Pepsi Rookie of the Year, which is fan voted, and Sauce won the actual Defensive Rookie of the Year award. I saw the post on Instagram with Hutchinson with the trophy, and I immediately got really upset and scared that he won it over Sauce. I mean, no disrespect to Hutch, but Sauce had a really great year and deserved it, Rookie of the Year for defense way more than Hutch. So glad he ended up getting it, but Hutchinson still scared me.
Yeah. And I want to say, Cam, I could definitely see your take being true. Suns got a great team, and I think
Finally,
it's
I've
here
been
to win
waiting
it.
so long.
They deserve to win it. D-Book stayed loyal to the Suns, so
Exactly.
and they deserve a ring. All right. My show and tell. I have this Brooklyn Nets winter
Beanie.
hat, I guess. Beanie, yes, that's the correct word. So I got this hat last year, and the Brooklyn Nets were stacked when I got this hat. They had KD, Kyrie, and James Harden. I thought they were gonna go really far, and then Harden
We all
requested
thought they were going to
trade.
win a ring. We all thought they were
Yeah.
going to win a ring.
And now all those players are gone. Not a single one of them on the Nets, but I still like this hat. I liked how it was, black and white. It matches with a lot, so I'm gonna keep wearing this. But sadly, all the players have left. But
Yeah, actually, kind of crazy stat that Brooklyn, the big three of KD, Kyrie, and Harden, only played 16 games together. 16 games together. I mean, that's just terrible. But yeah, I mean, I'm still going to be watching over the Nets. Cam Johnson, Mikal Bridges, got to make sure that they're doing okay over there. Some of my favorite players from Phoenix, got to make sure they're doing okay. But yeah, Brooklyn, crazy what happened. They blew it up and nobody was expecting it. I thought they were going to keep KD even after the Kyrie trade, but that didn't end up happening. All right, well, I think that's pretty much it for this episode. Be on the lookout because we have a very special episode coming very, very soon. That's all I'm going to say about it. So be on the lookout for our next episode.
It's going to be an exciting one.
Very excited about recording that episode. And other than that, follow us on social media like always. They'll be in the description below. Like and subscribe, comment any ideas. We started this thing on Twitter where we're going to be tweeting at Jake Mangum every day until he is a guest on our podcast. So be on the lookout for that. Interact with Jake on social media, try to get him on the podcast for us, try to help us out. But Imal, anything to add to this outro?
I think you've covered it all, Cam.
All right. Well, other than that, we're out.